Blog Talk Radio.
Tell me what you want, tell me what you see, where you want to go, what you want to be. If you have a dream, you can make it there with a lot of work and a lot of prayer. If you take your time, gotta be precise, gotta have a plan, double check it twice. Wait, hold up, slow down, devil need advice. Someone's gone before, maybe talk to them. Then after you do, go and talk to him. Wait, it's gonna come, maybe not tonight. Take your time today, take your time
to ride. Got a lot of friends, made a lot of ends. Twitter, you the trend, him a Bentley Benz. But you moving kind of fast. Keep sweats, you gotta make it last. Live every day like it's your last. But don't forget to have a blast.
Hello, hello. Welcome to Time Out. I am your host, Sylvia Crawley Milbury. Actually, I got married, for those who don't know, to Reginald Milbury, but I still go by Sylvia Crawley in the sports arena. Before we get started, I did want to say to all the listeners to remind you that my magazine, Monarch, is doing a women's empowerment series every Thursday at 3 p.m. We do it live. They're live Twitter chats. And this Thursday, we're featuring actress Wendy Davis from Army Wives. I'm a big fan of that show since I am an Army wife myself. But today, I have a very special guest lined up for you, Miss Marion Jones. Welcome to the show, Marion.
Thank you, Sylvia. I'm excited to be here chatting with you this evening.
I'm so excited. I've been counting down the hours all day. But
I know, because you've been texting me every hour.
I wanted to start the show by sharing a timeout moment for me that happens to involve you, Marion. My senior year in college, Mary and I both played at the University of North Carolina, and most people know her as a track. Most people know her as a track legend, but she was also a very, very gifted basketball player. And my senior year was Marion's freshman year. And at North Carolina, we have a big sister, little sister program where our coach, Sylvia Hatchell, she teams up upperclassmen with a freshman just so that they know where the first team meeting is. They know where to find the library. They, you know, if they have any problems on campus, they go to their big sister. So Marion was actually my little sister. I still call her baby girl. I had to change it up because she has a baby girl of her own now. She's a mother. So I said, I can't keep calling her baby girl, and she's like 30-something. So, but my timeout moment came in my senior year. Our record, we were national champions that year, and our record was 33-2. Our only two losses came to the same team, which was Virginia. And so the first time we played them, they kicked our butts. We didn't even know what happened. We were undefeated prior to that. We had never lost a game, so we really didn't know how to handle it well. And then we had to play them again. So the second time we played them, we watched film. We talked about our mistakes. We corrected some things, and we felt like, okay, we're going to get them this time. We played them the second time. They beat us again. We were devastated. So we went through the rest of the season, beat all the teams, got to the ACC tournament, went through our bracket fairly easily, and then we met up head-to-head with Virginia in a championship game for the ACC tournament title. And so we're going up against Virginia. We're in the locker room. We're preparing. I mean, we're in that Duke state of mind, kind of like when we play Duke now, but Virginia was our rival back then. And yeah. So Coach Hatchell gives the pregame speech of her life. I mean, she's just laying it on. I'm ready to just run out of the locker room immediately. and after we got done, Coach Hatchell says this thing in the locker room where she says, "Are you ready?" And we say, "Yeah, are you ready? Yeah, are you ready?" And we're just all hyped up. So we're jumping around like, "Yeah, we're ready." And we're lining up single file, shortest to tallest, like we always do to run out of the locker room. And I'm the captain, so I'm counting heads, and there's one person missing. It's Marion. So I run. I'm like, maybe she went to the bathroom. So I'm running around looking for her. Marion's back in the locker room sitting on the bench. And I said, "Marion, what's wrong? Are you sick? You need me to get the trainer? What's the, like, please don't be sick. Not today. Like, you know, we're playing Virginia. This is the day." And she looked me in my eyes with a game face that I've never seen in my life. But she looked me directly in my eyes, and she said, "I just want to win." And I thought, oh, wow. I had never encountered competition on that level. Now, I have to remind you that Marion was competing against Olympians at age 15. So she had already competed on the highest level before she even got to North Carolina. And we were just a bunch of silly, goofy kids. Like, we were cutting up, we're dancing during the warm-ups, we're dunking, all that kind of stuff. But at this moment, Marion had her game face on, and I saw a level of focus that I had never encountered before. I had a timeout moment. Charlotte Smith came in, and she said, "What's going on? Is everything okay? Is she okay?" I said, "She just wants to win, Charlotte." And Charlotte sat down like, oh, wow. And we just had a moment. After that, we went out on the floor. Everything we shot went in. I'm talking, I was throwing up shots, falling down, fading with one leg up, and it was going in. It was almost as if our entire team was in a zone. And I've experienced where I've had a zone, or maybe Charlotte was in a zone, or maybe Marion was in a zone, but collectively as a team, we were all in a zone. It was a very rare moment in my career to this day. But it started with that. I had never encounter someone so competitive who wanted to win so bad, and it transferred to our entire team to the point where the way we competed changed from that moment forward, and we weren't defeated the rest of that year to the point where we cut down the nets as national champions.
Yeah, you're right. I remember the moment, Sylvia, and it's one that, of course, we remember the national championship game, but that particular moment solidified, I think, in all of our heads, the team, that we had been saying all season long, want respect, because prior to that season and even preseason polls pretty much had counted us out and for various reasons. But we had told ourselves, I remember that first practice, the freshmen, we started saying, you know what, we're going to be national champion. Nobody else believed it. But we believed in, and I think that game was absolutely the turning point for us. And once we did it, there was absolutely no turning back. But it's a team that, sometimes you hear big-time players talk about there's a certain team that they've been a part of in their life that is unlike any other. Well, that particular team, no doubt, is one for me that all you guys are my sisters. I mean, we're not biological sisters. I don't have a biological sister, but you guys indeed are my sisters, because we've been through it all, and we're still together. I mean, I know I could easily pick up the phone at any time and call you or Charlotte or TJ or Coop, and you guys got my back. And it's a special, special group that Coach Hatchell and Coach Calder put together, so...
And that says a lot. I feel the same way, and that says a lot given how many teams we play for throughout our career.
You're right.
You know, there's a lot. There's a lot. And each team, you feel like, you know, they're your sisters, but that team, I think, will always have a special place in our hearts.
And it's beyond the national championship. I mean, that's special in and of itself, and particularly how we won it. But for whatever reason, if that 3-point basket had not gone in against La Tech in the national championship game, we would still be tight as ever. And I couldn't thank Coach Hatchell enough for pairing me up with you, because as a freshman coming cross country, kind of thrown into the mix. I remember Coach Hatchell calling me in her office not too long after I got on campus and saying, Marion, how do you feel about being point guard? I kind of laughed at her. You understand, I'm almost 6 feet, and when you're in high school, that type of height usually is a 5, maybe a 4. So my ball handling skills weren't quite up to par, but she saw something else, I suppose, in me, and I looked at her. I said, whatever you need, coach. I don't think she knew when I left that office that day. I'm thinking to myself, oh boy, Coach Caller, you got your work cut out for you. But I guess she knew what she was talking about, and it was a special, special time in my life, and one that I kind of wish, especially during March Madness every year when you see the teams play and I sit and I'll watch. And not many times do I say, gosh, I wish I could go back. But every year during March Madness, I wish I say, gosh, I wish I could be 17, 18, 19, 20 years old again to be a part of, you know, part of those teams. But, yeah, it was really a special time.
Yeah, I remember when it hit us one day. It was like just a random day, about 2 weeks after we won the national championship, when it just hit me and I start screaming. I call Charlotte. We're just having a moment. And people were like, is it just now hitting you that you're national champions? But you also played USA basketball on a USA basketball team with me. I believe it was the World University Games. Coach Hatchell was the coach, the head coach for that team. And Charlotte was on that team as well. We competed in Japan, but during the tryouts or either the practice, I remember you broke your ankle. And so you weren't able to travel to Japan with us to compete, nor were you able to run track anymore. And when I traced back the series of events in your life, I always go back to that time. I feel like that was maybe a critical point where things started to shift in your life. Can you talk about that time period?
Yeah, well, I can certainly remember being asked by Coach Hatchell that summer to come and to work out. And I certainly, in the basketball world prior to coming to Carolina, my name, you know, wasn't nearly as established as yours or Charlotte's. And, you know, playing on the team and us winning the national championship gave me a little bit more exposure. And thankfully, Coach Hatchell was the head coach, so she had most of the say in terms of her roster for the World University Games team. And so when she asked me, it was a great opportunity for me. So I remember I was in California that summer and I got the call and I flew to Colorado and I started practicing and I dove out of bounds trying to save a ball. And a good friend of mine now, Katie Smith, was on the opposing team and fell on the foot. I always tease her. I was like, oh, Katie, you see what you started? Jokingly, of course. But no, I wouldn't necessarily point to that moment, Sylvia. I would now that I'm almost 40 years old and I have had a lot of time to reflect. And I think it was many years before that moment. That was actually the second time that I had broken the foot, and it was actually a stress fracture in the fourth and fifth metatarsal, not necessarily the ankle. But while I was, I want to say a junior in high school, that was the first time that I had broken the foot. I had broken the fifth metatarsal in my foot. And it was the first time in my entire sports career, and it goes back until I'm six years old, but that was the first time that I couldn't participate in sport, any sport, because I was trying to rehab, I was healing. And for those 5 or 6 months in high school were some of the hardest of my life, because it forced me to kind of figure out and deal with a lot of pain that I had been facing. And that pain was caused by my parents being divorced at an early age and my biological father not taking any interest in my life. I was blessed that my mother remarried a wonderful man when I was 5 years old. When I turned 7, that same wonderful man had a massive stroke and he passed away. And so my entire childhood, I'm trying to deal with this idea of how, how you have one parent who loves you unconditionally, and that's my mom. And then you have another parent who, no matter what I do or say, seems not to want to come in the picture, not wants to be a part of my life. And I struggled with that. But I always found that sports was my outlet, and I excelled in it from a very young age. And I attribute some of that success because I put all of this negative energy that I had, and I put it into working out and training and getting better. And yes, I've been blessed with an incredible amount of physical talent, Sylvia. That's not even in question. But on top of that, like, I wanted to succeed. And in the back of my mind, I think it's always, I wanted acceptance from my biological father. I thought that there was something that I could have done to make him accept me. And so I thought, well, maybe if I train harder and I get better, you know, maybe he'll open up the paper one day and he'll see me, and then for whatever reason he'll be proud of me. It's, you know, when you're young, you think like that.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was, you know, 13, 14 years old, and I had that first major injury with the broken foot, and so I'm sitting out 4 or 5 months, and I didn't have sport, you know, and I really started to rebel at that time. I think I was, you know, like a freshman or sophomore, and I started acting out, not doing well in school. My mom was having problems.
I remember I came back to town, and you had gained some weight. And I was thinking, what's going on with Marion? You know, and I felt like, you know, things were turning. Things were shifting in your life.
Yeah,
at that
time.
And
then that was when I was in high school. But then when I had the injury after during the World University Games, that was the second time that it kind of all hit me. And once again, you know, I'm dealing with so much. Now I'm all the way across the country. I can't participate in sports, what I love doing. That's my outlet. You know, I was never the best student in the world, so I couldn't really rely on that. And just started to find myself in this nonstop, like, low self-esteem, just really, really dark place. And unfortunately, I never did anything about it. You know, I never told anybody about the pain that I was feeling. You know, I grew up, I'm a jock, and I'm a superstar athlete, and you kind of you have that armor, and people think that you're untouchable, that you're tough, that you know, nothing can hurt you.
That you don't have bad days.
Right. And then the more popular I get and the more successful I get, it's even that much harder to show your vulnerability and your pain, because people, especially after I graduated and really quickly became successful and very wealthy, people look to me for that strength, you know, that superwoman, right? So that's kind of like the persona that I took on. Like, you really at that point can't show people that you're hurting, because then you let people down, because they want to put that athlete on that pedestal. So you start just kind of, this cycle continues. And so after I graduated from college and after my freshman year, we won the title and we're just on top of the world, and you graduate and Samson and everybody, and, you know, we start this new era, and I'm more of a leader on the team. And it was just a wonderful experience for me. I did miss the sport of track and field while I was at Carolina. But I found how difficult it was to juggle both sports while in college. Of course, I was under a basketball scholarship there, so Coach Hatchell and the basketball squad had me until the end of our season, which, because we were so successful, went usually deep into March, mid-March. And so by the time I got out to the track, they were already into conference. So I had no type of base work for Carolina track. So I didn't do nearly as well while I was at Carolina in regards to my track and field career. And because of that, I missed it. I really missed the sport of track and field. I love my basketball. I love the team concept. But you got to understand, Sylvia, my first love was track and field. And I relish the idea of it's just me out on the track. I love the team concept. That was great for a few months of the year. But I love when the pressure was all on me. I mean, I loved it. And I missed it while I was in college, really. And so after I was injured and I rehabbed and I had to sit out a season, I redshirted a season, and I potentially could have taken my fifth year. Coach Hatchell made sure she shared that with me, that you know, it would be great if I came back for my fifth year. But I had made a promise to my mom that I was going to graduate from Carolina in 4 years, which I still could have done, and I could have pursued a secondary degree. But because I had been away from track, Sylvia, for those 4 years, and I missed it so bad that I made the decision in 1997 that I was going to graduate, that I was going to move on from Carolina, and then I was going to start my track career. And I'll have to tell you, probably I have had many difficult moments in my life, but one that really stands out to me is when, after I shared with Coach Hatchell and Coach Calder that I was going to go ahead and graduate and I wasn't going to be returning for my fifth year, Coach Hatchell then tells me, okay, so you know you have to go down there to the locker room and tell your teammates, you know, that you won't be returning. And I had a good hunch that she was going to tell me to do that, but that was like, oh, wow. So I can remember.
That's a tough conversation.
Oh, my gosh. I can remember taking those stairs down from Coach Hatchell's office. Now they have an elevator. Anyways, that's a whole nother point.
That's a whole nother story.
But I remember taking those stairs down and punching in the code to get in the locker room and walking back there, and my teammates just kind of strolling across the room and telling them that that I was not going to be returning next year, and then I was decided to run track. And what I most remember is, yeah, we were all in tears, but every single teammate came up to me and hugged me and told me good luck. It wasn't like a thing where anybody was upset with me because I wasn't going to be part of the team. Everybody hugged me like I was their sister. Like, we got your back. We're cheering you on. And I started the whole track career thing 13 weeks after graduating in 1997. I was U.S. national champion in the 100 meters and 200 meters. And if a month after that, I was world champion. So when I say success came my way very quickly, it did. But during that time, my senior year in college up until the success, I made some unfortunate choices to surround myself with people who really did not have my best interest at heart. And because success came my way so fast, I thought I was running things, right? I had surrounded myself with folks. I was making lots of money. So I distanced myself from the people in my life who would give it to me straight. We all have those people in our lives. A lot of times it's our parents, it's our mother, it's our coaches. But because I started to like the idea of everybody patting me on the back, saying how great you are, Marion, I distanced myself from the people who would say, you know what, Marion, what are you doing? What are you thinking, right? And I didn't want to hear that. And because I'm grown and I have a lot of resources, I distance myself. And it's one of the things that I share with young people when I speak now. Be very careful whom you associate with, right? Because if you're surrounding yourself with people who are making poor choices, the chances of you making poor choices are very, very high. And
wow. That's a tweetable moment right there.
I gotta jump in. Okay,
man.
All right.
I'm sorry. You have someone in the chat room that's talking about the same exact thing. Her name is Raven Whitaker, and her question for you is, how did you manage doing all these sports with the limelight and stuff, and then who did you look up to, and groom yourself after? And she says she loves your book. She read the book. She reads it every day. And please follow her at Raven Whitaker. I promise I'll get that out there. But since you're on that story, please talk to this young lady individual. You have a person right here, right now, listening, and you can talk to her directly. So I would love for that to take place.
Well, I mean, when I was growing up, there were a few people whom I absolutely adored. I was born in Los Angeles, and so I was a big Lakers fan, and one of the athletes whom I absolutely adored was Byron Scott. I remember going to his basketball camp, but more on a hero type level, I loved Evelyn Ashford and Jackie Joyner Kersee, and I absolutely wanted to be like them. And in 1984, as I mentioned, I'm from Los Angeles, and in 1984, I was 9 years old. And that was the first summer, that was the first time that I witnessed the Olympic Games. We didn't have enough money for me to attend the actual events, but I can remember that summer sitting in front of my television and watching the athletes cross the finish line and knowing that I wasn't in awe of, like, the whole gold medal thing, but I was in awe of the euphoria on their face. Whatever they were feeling when they crossed that finish line, I knew that I wanted and had to experience that at some point in my life. So I could remember that summer going to my bedroom. My mother had purchased a chalkboard for me to write my homework assignments on, and I erased all that, and I wrote that I was going to be an Olympic champion. And from that moment on, really was the big moment for me that kind of set things in motion on what I wanted to do in my life. But to go back to Raven's initial question, how did I handle the pressure? I always like to say that I have always been the type of individual who sets my goals very high. One, I'm a goal setter. And I always encourage young people to learn all about goal setting. Sit down, write it out, make yourself accountable, put it on your mirror. What do you want to do? Look at it every day. Say it over and over in your head until you believe it. From 9 years old, I tell you, I wrote it on my chalkboard. And I would write goals down for myself throughout my career. And my goals superseded anything that any media, any person could ever fathom, right? So that when people in 1999, when I was in a press conference and somebody asked me what I wanted to accomplish in the 2000 Olympics, and I flippantly told the world that I wanted to pursue 5 gold medals in Sydney, and the world took this story and ran with it, and it was such a big deal. And I said it flippantly because I had already written out my goals years before, and that was my goal. So it wasn't any big deal to me. You understand what I'm saying? And so what I would like to tell Raven and whoever else is interested, you know, my goals are so much higher than what so many people ever even fathomed. And that's how I dealt with the pressure. And so it wasn't pressure for me. It was just kind of what I expected of myself. And, you know, I'm still a goal setter, even though now I'm out of the sporting world. I write down what my plans are for the future, short-term goals and my long-term goals. And I look at it and I study it and I pray about it. And I see it to fruition. Like I don't stop just because there's a bump in the road. There are going to be bumps in the road. I hope I answered Raven's question.
You did. Hey, Vic, we have Coach Hatchell on the line. Can you put her through? That's our coach from North Carolina.
Yes, I will put her through right now. Actually, she said she wanted to listen, but I'll bring her on. We're going to force her to talk. Coach Hatchell. Coach Hatchell, welcome to the show. You have Sylvia and Marion right here. You can chastise them again right now. You know there's an elevator. And make them punch
Hi, Coach Hatchell. Thank you for tuning in today.
Hey guys.
Hi, Coach.
Hey.
Hey
Are
guys.
You in Chapel
no.
Hill?
No, I'm in my place in the mountains.
Oh, okay. Must be nice.
I got a room full of people here, but we're all listening.
All right. Well, Coach, I sent you a message after all of the incredible success, but I hadn't had a chance to talk to you, so let me be the first on this call quickly to say congratulations. I love you. We're so proud of you.
And we're planning to be at the Hall of Fame this year, Coach Hatchell.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it. I love both of you. I'm very proud of you.
Yeah, thank you,
Thank
Coach.
You very much. All right, so, Marion, let's talk about, a lot of people don't understand, it's very difficult when you're an everyday person and you go through things and maybe you make a mistake or you don't make the right choice and you do that in front of your friends and your family and it's, you know, it's embarrassing, a little humiliating and you're trying to bounce back from that. But it's another thing when you're in the limelight. And like you said, you announced that you wanted to compete for 5 medals and win 5 gold medals. And then the media mm-hmm. just takes the story and they run with it. Now the whole world is watching. Can you talk about the amount of pressure that it is mm-hmm. when you happen to not make the right choice and the world is watching you deal with that?
Yeah.
Can we transition into that somehow?
Yeah, we can. I mean, it's indescribable. I'll tell you. I joke with people now, and I say, well, you know, be very careful what you wish for. I can remember being a young person, and I wanted my name, Sylvia, so desperately bad to be in the paper when I was young.
right? All I wanted to see was Marion Jones wins this or Marion Jones. I can remember, like, telling my older brother, I have one older brother, one brother. I can remember telling him, you know, Albert, you wait, my name's going to be in the paper. And now I like to say, sometimes I don't want to see my name in the paper because it's not always good, right? So be careful what you wish for. But, you know, it's one of those things. It's a double-edged sword because you want the world to share your success, right? That's what we all want. We want the world to know about our accomplishments, right? And mm-hmm. when we don't necessarily do what we're supposed to do, whether it's not perform well or even worse, really do something that you shouldn't, then you have to expect. I mean, if you're wanting the world to share with your success, you have to expect that it's going to share with you in your failure as well. And so once I went through so many of my challenging moments, I can tell you, though, I never questioned why the media and the world took to the story. So, you know, when I was running fast and I was playing well and I was doing all these great things, I couldn't wait to open the paper, you know, and see your name. But you have to expect the same if you don't do what you're supposed to do. And the way I handled the pressure, I suppose, was I didn't open the paper. And I tried to run, no pun intended, or hide from it all. But because you're such a public figure and I'm a public figure, it's very, very hard. So there were months and weeks that you don't come out of the house a lot because I have a very recognizable face, a smile, and it's hard to, you know, disappear. And it's a challenge. I mean, even now that I have kids and, you know, I have the business side of me, and when I have to go and speak, there's a certain, but then when I'm with my family and you want to just be mom and wife, there are many times you wish that people didn't recognize you as much so that it doesn't put any hiccups when it comes to family time. And so the pressure is enormous. And I think a lot of celebrities and athletes have a very hard time with it. I think I coped with it as well as can be, primarily because, one, I achieved a lot of success while I was young, and so I learned how to deal with the media and watch. I can remember when I was very young, my stepfather, before he passed away, he was a big Dodgers fan. He was a big Lakers fan. And I can remember after the games, him making me watch the post-game interviews, and he would tell me, he'd say, little girl, he said, look at the difference in these athletes when they lose and when they win and how they talk to the media, right? You see how their shoulders are hunched. You see how they're trying to get away from certain questions. And so it's funny because I was probably getting media training when I was 6 and 7 and 8 years old, years and years before other people. So I don't know. North Carolina taught me so many things, but I think in terms of how I handle myself with the media was inbred in me a long time before. And I learned the hard way. I did a lot of bumps in the road, but eventually you learn, you know, you have to keep your private life and your public life separate. And I wish right. I would have, you know, done that a lot earlier on in my career, but.
Let's talk about, I want the listeners to get an understanding of just how well things were going for you, how high you mm-hmm. had climbed. There was a time where you were winning $80,000 per event, and mm-hmm. you would run multiple events, you know, and sometimes mm-hmm. there was a car included in that prize. You had endorsements with Nike. Talk a little bit about some of the success that you were experiencing at the peak of your career.
Wow. Well, you know, like I briefly mentioned earlier, not too long after graduating from college, you know, success and I, you know, collided really quick, head on. And, I was, you know, the top athlete in the world for a number of years there. I was winning races and traveling in Europe were athletics, or what we call track and field, but it's called athletics overseas, is the number one sport behind football or soccer, as we call it. And so every stadium that I competed in was
packed, and people were coming out to see me, and they paid me very, very well, very, very well. I was on the cover of you name the magazine. I was on Vogue and Time and People and Ebony and Jet, and the list goes on, and endorsements from, I mean, you name it, American Express, The Tag, Hoyer, to Nike, to Pepsi, to Kellogg's. I mean, it just went on, and was definitely riding high, living the life. I was irresponsible with my money. I was young. I was irresponsible in my relationships. I, as I mentioned earlier, you know, were letting people in my bubble, as I like to say, that, you know, weren't there because they truly cared for me. They were there because of what I could ultimately do for them. And I failed to really look at the red flags that indeed were there. You know, in hindsight, I could, you know, sit here and say there were absolutely, Sylvia, red flags along the way and little things that happened here or there that, you know, if I was really being honest with myself, I should have said, you know what, that's just not right. Mary, and if I had kept the people around me who would have given it to me straight, you know, they would have said, Marion, can you not see what's going on here? Right? But like, because I moved away from those people, you know, I didn't have that buffer. And in 2000 I went to Sydney and I had a lot of success. I won the 5 medals, 3 gold and 2 bronze. And in 2003.
So you accomplished the goal that you publicized.
Well, no, I accomplished the goal of winning 5 medals, but not of my goal of winning 5 gold medals. And so leaving Sydney, I was certainly disappointed and people were confused by that. But once again, like I mentioned, my goals were here. And when I don't reach my goal, there's a sense of disappointment because I certainly could have. You know, it's not like they were so out of reach. It was right there. So, yes, I was disappointed. So in 2000, to fast forward a little bit, in 2003, it was right around that time where there was just a lot of media speculation about professional athletes and performance-enhancing drugs. And there was a particular laboratory in San Francisco that reportedly was making these performance-enhancing drugs for athletes. And my name got caught up in it all, right? And in 2003, I was asked by federal investigators to fly out to San Francisco and to share with them any knowledge that I had about this particular lab and performance-enhancing drugs. Well, at that time...
Was this normal for athletes, for them to ask athletes to fly somewhere and talk about any performance-enhancing drugs that they have?
This whole situation wasn't normal. I mean, this was a huge case, and I don't know that there is any precedent. I don't know if it's ever been, but during that time, around 2003, 2002, 2004, they were targeting certain athletes, and my name had come up in it all. And when I was asked by the federal investigators to come out there, and my attorneys told this to me, I said, no problem. I believed in a drug-free sport, still do, and had absolutely nothing to hide, right? And so I told them, sure, I'll go out to San Francisco and share if I know anything, and I don't, but sure, I'll go out there and I'll share with them and answer any questions that they have. And so I went out there, and prior to – let me back up. Prior to making the trip, the federal investigators – contacted my attorneys and said, we have this document. It's called a Queen for a Day letter. And in essence, what this is if you come in and speak with us and you are open and you are honest, right, no matter what you tell us, you can never be prosecuted for it, right? A lot of times the Queen for a Day letter is given to murderers or people who drug dealers or people whom they're trying to when they're trying to get whoever's at the top of the chain. Right, they're trying to get somebody else. And so my attorneys looked over the letter, you know, shared with me that it would be, you know, a great idea for me to sign this, especially if I'm going in there and I'm going to be honest. So I signed this Queen for a Day letter. So I flew to San Francisco and I started meeting with these investigators. And the interview was supposed to last about an hour, and it wound up being over 3 hours. And
wow.
Very early on in the interview, we realized, my attorneys and I, that that many of these, like, they thought that I was involved in everything, right? The questions were very direct. They were very aggressive with me, so much that my attorneys on a few different occasions had to actually call a timeout, you know, and go and speak with the federal investigators outside in the hall, and they would come back. So after about hour three, right, one of the federal investigators leaned into his, had a black bag sitting on the ground next to him, and pulled out a little Ziploc bag. And in this bag, he shook it, and I'm sitting across from him at a long conference table, and I have an attorney on each side, and there are three of them on the other side of the conference table. And he has this little Ziploc bag, and inside of the bag is a little, like, vial with liquid in it. And he's shaking it in front of me, and he's asking me very direct and blunt and angrily, you know what this is? What is this? Well, immediately, Sylvia, when he pulled this out of the bag, I recognized what it was. I recognized that it was something that I had been given and something that I had taken prior to the Sydney Olympic Games, right? And it's what I had heard about in the news at this time of this particular performance-enhancing drug called the Clear. And up until this point, people had asked me about it, and I told them I don't know what it is because I didn't. I had no idea that what I had been given prior to the Olympic Games was indeed the Clear. It was told to me that it was something else. So when they're shaking this across my face, I immediately, Sylvia, recognized what it was, right? And in, mm-hmm. It's like my whole life flashed in front of my face, and I realized that, all right, so, and this is very quickly, not as long as I'm telling the story. I mean, it's in the span of 30 seconds, right? I make the decision that if I tell them the truth, right, that I knew what it was, that I had taken it, right, and that I had taken it to the prior games, prior to the Olympic Games, everything that I had worked for my entire life, every dream that I had would be taken away from me, right? So in the span of those 30 seconds, I chose to lie to them and tell them that I did not know what it was, right, and that I had never taken it, right? So much that they were upset, they called the interview, and we went our separate ways. Now, after I left that interview, I distanced myself from the group that I had been around, the particular coach, everybody whom I was around during that time. And I decided, you know what? All right, it's a lie. I lied. But maybe I can cover it up and get through this, right? And as we all know, one little lie most of the time turns into a bigger lie, a bigger lie, a bigger lie. But, you know, I distanced myself from those people. I'm still competing. I'm still winning races. You know, and I'm still the best female athlete in the world, but the weight of this lie became heavier and heavier every single day. In addition, in 2003, I also had my first son, and I can remember, you know, trying to teach him the right way and, you know, tell him, you know, son, when you make a mistake, when you make a poor choice, you know, you have to come and tell mom. And then we deal with the consequences, and then life moves on. But then I would turn around, I'd look in the mirror, Sylvia, and I'd say to myself, "What a hypocrite! What a hypocrite you are, Marion!
Wow!
You know, you're telling your son this, but you're not living this. You're not living this, right? You're carrying this lie, right? But at the same time, you know, I'm trying to live a certain lifestyle. My family was living in a certain lifestyle." And so I carried this lie. I'm still winning races now, understand me. I'm still the best athlete in the world, but every day this is getting heavier and heavier. I'm so
wow,
much.
Wow, time out,
but,
time out right
okay.
there. We're going to take
right.
a time out. We have a question, and it's in line
okay.
with what you're saying. One of the listeners wanted to know, what are the expectations of your children, and are they
yes.
athletic? So, I mean, if they're athletes, you know, what are your expectations for them?
Yeah. Well, I have three kids. I have a 9-year-old, 5-year-old, and a 3-year-old. And all of my kids are just naturally blessed with athletic, physical talent. It's no doubt when you see them compete.
Oh,
when they're
oldest
their
son,
sports.
In my opinion, is the fastest baby in the world. Fastest little boy in the world.
But my husband and I, though, we try and bring balance to our household, so our kids participate in sports, and they're very good at it, but we make sure that their priority is their school. They all participate in art class. They do music. And so if they decide that they want to pursue a career at some point in sports, we will certainly support them, but not necessarily have to point them in the direction just because their parents participated in at such a high level. I'm very careful about that. They decide pretty much which sports they want to compete in. My boys right now participate in flag football and in basketball, and they participated in soccer. My daughter does gymnastics and soccer, and I mean, you name it. So we pretty much give them the lead in terms of what they like doing. Where are their friends? And when they get older, I'm sure it'll become a lot more specific, and we'll give them certain advice about certain things. But we always tell them, you know, there is no sport unless you do what you're supposed to in the classroom, period. I don't care how great you are. And that's just the way it goes down in our house. But yeah, they don't even know how athletic they are, really. A lot of times when I'm sitting on the sidelines, I'll give you a funny story, and I know we're getting low on time, but so when my oldest son, when he first started participating in sport, and it's the first time I've had that trying to figure out how to separate the competitor in me, right, and the mom, right? So I'm sitting on the sideline, and I'm watching my son, who is just a blaze of fire. Like, he is so quick, so, I mean, just gone. When I first got to Carolina, Coach Hatchell told me a story, or I don't know if Coach Hatchell or Coach Collar, and they said that Billy Moore, she was a coach at UCLA a number of years ago, famous coach, and when she was recruiting me, she shared with Coach Hatchell or some other coach that Marion is an amazing athlete, so amazing that when she's on the court, she's up there, but unfortunately the ball is however many feet behind her that I have outrun the ball. And so I'm watching my son, right, and he's just blazing up and down the court. But that competitive drive, right, that you talked about when we were in that locker room prior to playing Virginia, that I just naturally have, right, it's not natural for everybody. But I have a hard time understanding that, right, even still now to this day. It's one of those things I'm just like, the ball is right there. Don't you do anything that you possibly can, whether it's dive on the floor, skin up your knee, bust your jaw, break your foot to get that ball. That's just the way that I think, right? But not everybody thinks like that. And my son is not at that point yet, right? And so I'm sitting there on the sideline. He's playing basketball, and the ball is right there. And my husband had to kind of like, he was sitting next to me, kind of like tap my leg, like, Mary, you know, you got to calm down a little bit, right? And then
calm
the first
down,
time
honey.
I thought, you know, I have to switch gears. I'm mom out there, right? As successful as I was in an athlete, I have to separate that and kind of let them come into their own and kind of like bite my lip and just like, yay, good job, right? And it is a challenge. It is probably one of the hardest things that I have to deal with now in my life, which is saying a lot because I have been through some bumps in the road. And so if that's one of the hardest things in my life, well, life is good then, isn't it? And God is good. If I have been on
good.
This journey, and that right now is one of the toughest things in my life. But where are we? Okay, really quick. Let me go back.
I think, Vic,
so,
Vic, do you have someone who wants to ask a question?
Actually, I do, because, you know, Mary, you're just rolling right into these questions that I got from the callers. We have a Carice Thompson on the line. He's been holding for a minute. And he works at a job corps for young women. And I'm going to let him ask his question. It's pretty much something that you can speak about. Carice,
okay.
You're on the line with Marion. Now, you said you had a question. Don't ask funny because I got the hang-up button right here, too. So
yeah,
question.
Okay, no problem. I'm not going to have funny. Just a little nervous because I've been loving Marion Jones since I was like a young boy.
How are you doing, Carice?
I'm doing all right, ma'am. Well, my main question is that I'm around a lot of women. I work in a girls' dormitory at Clearfield Job Corps Center in Utah. And I'm teaching my girls to try to take pride in themselves and goal set because, you know, they don't come from houses and homes that teach that, you know, Job Corps, if you know anything about, it's about at-risk youth. I was at-risk youth. And it would be great to know, like, what type of, like, things you did in your life and goals you set and how did you complete those goals so I can maybe tell my girls on Thursday when I have my group because it's, like, big to me.
Yeah. Well, I would say the first thing is to sit them down and to tell them, first of all, how a blessing they are, right, and how great they are, right, just period, besides the fact that, you know, they might not come from a household or a family that's very successful. They might not have a lot of money, but the first thing that I would do is tell them is how wonderful they are, just because they're unique. And then beyond that, in terms of taking those small steps to success, you know, I share with people that there are a couple factors when it comes to finding success in life. And you will see many of these qualities in many successful people across sports, business, whatever it is, right? And the first thing I always like to say is, as you might have heard me mention earlier in this interview, first of all is be careful whom you associate with, right? Tell the girls to look to their left and look to their right, right? And all the people that they're hanging with, are they people who are prone to drama, who they're hanging out with? Are there people who are making poor choices in their own life, right? The chances if they're hanging around these people, they're going to make some of the same poor choices. So start to distance themselves from those people right away, right? The second thing is to get good, sound, mature advice from people in their life who will give it to them straight, right? Not necessarily their peers. It doesn't have to be their mother or their father, right? But somebody in their life, a mentor, could be a pastor, could be a coach, whomever, who has lived, who has real life experience, right? And who loves them for them, regardless of what they can do for them, and get good sound advice from them, right? And then lastly, once you get that advice, don't just sit on it. Do something about it, right? If they're in a dark place mm-hmm. in their life right now, if they're depressed, if they have low self-esteem, right? Start to set goals to slowly pull themselves out of that, right? By staying in that dark, dark place, it's not helping anybody, certainly not themselves, right? When I was in my dark, dark place, 49 days solitary confinement, when I was locked up, right? And I thought to myself, what can I do with my life now? You know what? I made the choice that, for one, nobody's going to stop me. I might be in this place right now. I won't be here forever. But when I get out, I have a story to tell. I have a voice. I'm going to try and change and help the lives of people, young people, make better choices in their own life. I did something about it. I could have easily stayed in that dark, dark place, right? I could have stayed there and let, you know, oh, woe is me, pity me, sympathy, please. First of all, that's not me at all. But I pulled myself out of it and made a change. I made a difference. And so that's what I would share with them. If you could hopefully you took some of those notes down, but that's what I would share with them. First thing, tell them how special they are just because they are unique and they are here, right? And then next go through each of those points. And those are some of the steps to success.
Well,
that's sound advice.
That was great advice. I wrote down everything you said. I mean, like, these girls, it's just so important that they know this. And I mean, I'm young, I'm only 28, and I went to Job Corps when I was 22, and I did those type of things, pulled myself out of those dark places, and I tried to explain that to them, but, you know, like, it's just little old me, you know, just another residential counselor, you know. They don't think, I mean, some of them think highly of me, and some of them think, oh, it's just another guy, I'm here at Job Corps, you know.
Yeah.
But I think that, you know, from what I wrote and what I'm going to explain to them and just talking to you, I mean, because there's a lot of, we have you actually, a picture of you up in our dorm. So that's why I, like, called you. Yeah, like,
but
our girls' dorm has all kinds of, like, the horn and everything.
I think a lot of times mentors, teachers, educators, coaches, sometimes they feel that the same thing, that, you know, they're not getting to the girls, they're not getting their point across. And a lot of times people will just kind of like throw their hands up in the air. Oh, well, you know, I'm not getting through to them, right? And you never know, that next time that you tell them a certain song, give them a piece of advice, that might be the time that it clicks with them, right? Don't give up. Don't stop. Just because maybe they're not showing an interest, or maybe they're rolling their eyes, or maybe they're talking, right? You never know that one moment, right, that one of those girls will be open, right, to hearing the message, and it will finally sink in, and then it will be all worth it. Like, so don't throw your hands up in the air. Don't give up on them, right? So many people in their life probably have, right, you know, and probably will. Like, don't be that person who just says, you know what, I don't have time for it. No, it could be that one moment that you can change somebody's life. And it's
right.
when I travel to speak, right, it's such a sacrifice when I have to, you know, leave my home. I have three young kids. My husband's in law school right now, and so we have so much going on. And so when I have to travel to speak, it's a huge sacrifice for a lot of reasons. One, I don't necessarily want to be away from my family. Two, what I'm going to speak about is hard. It's hard for me. I mean, I'm a good speaker. I'm good with people. But the topic matter is one that hits me at the core every time I have to share about my journey, right? And so it's not easy. But I do it. I do it for one, I could be a living example to my kids that once you make a poor choice, you don't give up. Two, I've had young people come up to me and say, Marion, we thank you. We appreciate you. It's what my kid needed to hear today. Or they have listened to me and they have taken a moment, taken a break to make a right choice.
Taking a time out.
And that makes it worth it. That makes it worth it for me that even if one person's life is changing in a positive way because of hearing my tough journey, then it is worth it. And I like to say that God does not give you more than you can handle. We've all heard that. We've all heard it over and over in our lives. But it is so true. And I like to think, wow, he must think I'm one bad mama jamma, right? To have, you know, put me through so much. Because he believes in me. He knows I can handle it, right? Not everybody could handle it. So many people possibly could have succumbed to the pressure of everything. But he knows I can handle
right.
it. And just the thought of that, Sylvia, Carice, you know, just the thought of that makes me feel, wow, I am special, I am unique, even in those dark moments, and I still have them where I struggle with forgiveness, and I know I've hurt and let so many people down. I'm human, like, I still deal with stuff in my life. I'm a work in progress, I like to say, but the fact that I know he knows that I'm special and I'm unique and I'm helping people, and I think I'm making so much bigger, a bigger difference in the lives of people than when I ran a race in 10.65 seconds. You know, to me, it just means
right.
to compare.
Okay, I got to jump in right here. Carice, don't give up on your kids. Thank you for what you do in the lives of young people. We got to move on with the show. All right, so we are running out of time. We have 3 minutes left to the show. And so if you're online, if you call in, we can move past our hour show. We can go beyond that. We can go for 2 hours if we need to with Marion. But you can only hear it if you're calling in. The number is 347-637-3220. So if you're online, you may want to call in now so you can get the rest of the show. Marion, I heard your attorney when I was watching ESPN 30 for 30 say that when they pulled out the vial that was in the Ziploc baggie and they said, have you ever seen this drug before? Mm-hmm. He said at that moment you needed a timeout. You needed like a 30-second timeout to just consult your attorney or, you know, your team around you to and just take a minute to think really about what you wanted to say. Can you talk about how that split second changed the next, you know, several
years
of your life?
Years of my life. Yeah, well, I think, you know, my attorneys actually did call a timeout during that time. It was right before the federal investigators pulled out the Ziploc bag. They did call a timeout, right? And I had that 30 seconds to talk with them. And this was before, you know, I made that poor choice. But I failed. What I failed to do is once I saw what was in this bag, at that point is when I should have called a timeout, right? At that point, I should have said, well, I need to take a break. And that's your timeout and my take a break are nearly identical, Sylvia, in that, you know, when you get to your life and you have to encounter tough moments in your life, right? You're saying you need to take a time out. I tell people you need to take a break. You need to take a step back, right? To really think about the consequences of your choices, right? And if you do that, I'm so confident. Most of us know the difference between right and wrong, right? And if you sit back and young people, if you're hearing this, right? And I understand this whole idea of peer pressure and wanting to look cool and not wanting to be the oddball out when it comes to your friends, right? And so a lot of times they go along with the negative behavior or whatever's going on. But pretend like you have a cell phone call you have to make, or pretend like you have to go to the bathroom, right? Make that phone call to somebody who's going to give you some good sound advice. Take a break. It could be 30 seconds. It could be 20 seconds. It could be a minute, and think about the consequences of your choices, right? And so what I failed to do, I failed to take a break during that moment. And I could have. I could have looked to my right. I could have looked to my left and said, hey, guys, I need to talk with you a second. That would have been perfectly fine, and they would have been able to give me, like, real advice. Like, Marion, if you make this choice, this is what is going to happen. Marion, if you make this choice, it's going to be hard, but it's going to be a lot easier, right? If
right.
I would have
Let's
done
take a
that,
time
and they
out
would have,
right there. We got to take a timeout right there. We need to close out the show. If you are listening, we ask that you meet us at the same time every Monday night at 7 p.m. Time Out with Sylvia Crawley. If you want to continue to listen, you can call in at 347-637-3220. Again, that's 347-637-3220. Take a time out with Sylvia Crawley.
What you want, tell me what you see, where you wanna go, what you wanna be. If you have a dream, you can make it there with a lot of work and a lot of prayer. If you take your time, gotta be precise, gotta have a plan, double check it twice. Wait, hold up, slow down, devil need advice. Someone's gone before, maybe talk to them. Then after you do, go and talk to him. Great, it's gonna come, maybe not tonight. Take your time today, teach you something right.
Got a lot of friends, made a lot of ends. Twitter, you the trend, him a Bentley Benz. But you moving kind of fast. Keep sweats, you gotta make it last. Live every day like it's your last. But don't forget to have a blast.
All right, we are back. Time Out with Sylvia Crawley. We have Marion Jones here. Marion, we're going to keep going if that's all right with you. People don't want it to end, so we're just going to keep going.
Okay.
So you were talking about taking a time out, find that time to just regroup, recess, and that's the purpose of the show. Our purpose is, you know, a time out is that moment where you pause, you assess the situation, you correct some things, you regroup, and you resume with an opportunity to perform better. And so what you're saying is that was a moment where you needed to take a time out right there.
Absolutely. And, you know, I can go back to certain moments, even years before then. You know, when I was injured for the first time in high school, and I had those 5 or 6 months that I was just in a very dark place, low self-esteem, and what I should have done was taken a time out then and, you know, shared with my mom or whoever else in my life that I was hurting, that I was in pain, and that I'm dealing with a lot of stuff. Or when I was in college and I broke my foot for that next time, and I had those same 4, 5, 6 months where I was just really in a dark place, I could have easily gone one of my coaches or my mom or whoever in my life and told them once again, hey, I'm just dealing with some stuff. I should have taken a time out. I should have taken a break and thought about, you know, figure out what's going on with me. And instead I didn't. And so, yeah, I mean, I could certainly go back to several moments in my life that I should have taken a time out or taken a break and thought about, you know, my choices and my actions.
Yes. So now they've asked you the question. You lied and told them that you've never seen it before.
Mm-hmm.
Now what happens after that?
Yeah.
Now
well,
you've
got
to live with this secret.
I got to live with it, but I need to live. So I'm still competing. I distance myself, like I told you, from those people who, you know, were around me at the time, and I'm still winning races, but you know, the burden is becoming heavier and heavier, so much that in 2007, I had finally entered into a relationship that was a positive one, and it was the best one for me. I met my husband, and we married, and I wanted to so desperately start fresh. You know, I wanted to start new. You know, you're a newlywed. You want to start on the best footing with this person whom you're going to want to spend the rest of your life with. Any baggage that's there, you want to get rid of it so that you guys have the best chance to make this thing work. And that's how I was. I also, you know, I had a son. I was about to have another child. And I said, you know what? Things have to, I have to get rid of this baggage. I need to make a change. And by that point, I had moved to Austin, Texas, and I had found a wonderful church, a wonderful church family. And my husband and I prayed about it, and I decided that I was finally going to, you know, get rid of this baggage. I was going to get it all out there, and we were going to deal with whatever the consequences were going to be by me finally coming clean. And we certainly, at that time, didn't know that they would be as extreme as they wound up being. So in 2007, made the decision that I was going to finally go ahead and, you know, share with federal investigators that I had lied. And because of that, I pled guilty to 2 counts of making false statements to federal investigators. A lot of people think that I went to prison because I took performance-enhancing drugs. That's not the case. I went to prison because I signed that Clean for a Day letter that I talked about earlier in the show, whereby if I had not lied, you know, nobody could have prosecuted me. It wasn't an offense. But because I did and I signed the letter, I had to plead guilty.
Wow.
A few months later, during that time, after I pled guilty, well, let me back up a little bit. The night before everything was supposed to come out in the papers and everything, I sat down at my computer and I had already shared with my immediate family and my close friends what I was going through, what was about to happen. But there were so many other friends and family that I didn't have time to pick up the phone. So I sat down on my computer the night before I was to travel to New York to plead guilty, and I wrote the hardest email that I've ever had to write in my life. And I told each of them about what I had done, what was going to happen, and it was the hardest thing. I sat at that computer for 3 or 4 hours, and the hardest moment was when I had to hit send, and that email went out. And the uncertainty of knowing that, you know, I was going to lose probably people whom I thought were friends, and that it was all out there. I mean, there was no turning back at that moment. And lo and behold, before I got up from that chair in front of that computer, it was just a few moments after I hit send, Sylvia, and I received 10, 15, 20 emails from family and friends saying, you know what, Marion? Yeah, you messed up, but we love you regardless, right? And we're there with you no matter what. And that was what I needed. And I went to bed, and I woke up the next morning, and I traveled to New York, and I pled guilty. And what happens after you plead guilty is, before a judge can sentence anybody, the probation department's like a team of people, right, who they will investigate the case, investigate the person, their history, their schooling, their background, and they will then give what's called a recommendation to the judge on what the person's sentence should be. Ultimately, of course, the judge has the final say. They always do, but many times, their decision rests heavily on what the recommendation of this probation department is. And so there were two or three months in between my me pleading guilty and the sentencing, and they had those few months to do their investigation. And their recommendation was that it would best for me and for the community, not for me to go to prison, but for me to be on probation and help the community, different types of community service, helping young people make better choices, and all of that. And that's the recommendation that was given to the judge. And my attorneys and I knew that ultimately the judge can do whatever he wants, but we were very, very confident going into that courtroom that day that that I would be given probation and however many years of community service. Well, normally a sentencing of this sort lasts, you know, 30, 45, maybe an hour tops. Well, 2.5 hours into my sentencing, I turn around and I look at my husband and I look at my attorneys and I have to ask them, did he say 6 months incarceration? Like, we were all floored. I had never known anybody that had been to prison. I had nothing, didn't know what to expect. I was going to, you know, be away from my family. I was, I mean, my only experience with prison was watching the MSNBC lockup shows that we all watch, and they always seem so extreme, right? And so we were in shock, utter and complete shock, Sylvia, that this particular judge felt that, and as he said in the sentencing, that I was going to be used as an example, and just utter and complete shock. So, I mean, we left there. My husband and I made the choice to send our boys. By that point, I had two kids. I had two sons to send our kids. My husband is from Barbados, so we sent them to Barbados to stay with their grandparents just because there was so much paparazzi and media attention regarding me and the case at that time, and we wanted to protect them. And I started to prepare as well as I could for 6 months in jail. And there's no way to prepare. There is no how-to book when it comes to going to prison. And
right.
My husband, on that particular day, we drove to Fort Worth, Texas, which is about a three-hour drive from where I live. And I turned myself in. And on that day, I was whatever inmate number, walked in, and it's always nice to be, usually when people enter prison, they are anonymous. Not many people know about their crime or who they are. I walked into prison, and there were helicopters circling the prison. My news story was on the TV where the inmates were watching, and I certainly wasn't anonymous. But I'll tell you, though, Sylvia, it was an incredible blessing for me to have gone there because it forced me. It forced me to slow down, no pun intended. It forced me to figure out my priorities and figure out what's important. And that's not, you know, what type of car you drive, how many houses you have, how fast you run, right? It's your relationship with God and your family, figuring out who
right.
you are and how you can help people. And I don't know how
it's any
other.
Mm-hmm. I can remember, Marion, when you got sentenced to go to prison, I was watching, and I said, she is being incarcerated, but
mm-hmm.
she's finally free.
Yeah,
like, I
yeah,
just felt
yeah.
in my heart that you were finally free of all of this, and you didn't have to hide
yeah.
anymore. You didn't have to keep any secrets. You didn't have to lie. You,
yeah.
you know, you could just pay, you know, pay your price for whatever you did and move
yeah.
on with your life, you know. And so although I was very sad and, you know,
mm-hmm.
in tears when it all went down, I felt that you were free. And it's the strangest
yeah.
thing. I remember explaining it to my mom.
Yeah, I when I was released from prison, I had the interview, well, one of the interviews with Oprah, and one of her first questions to me was, you know, how did you feel after when I stood on the courtroom steps after everything happened, and I gave you know, the press conference, and she said, well, how did that feel? I said, I felt a sense of relief. You know, I knew that the road ahead was going to be tough, but it was done. It was all in the past. I paid the consequence, and I was going to move on. And my 6 months in prison were an incredible blessing because I met some of the most incredible women. A lot of people are like kind of snub their nose or whatever when I say that. But I learned while I was in there that, one, everybody makes a mistake, right? You know, some mistakes are a lot worse than others, yeah. But everybody makes a mistake, right? And I learned that a lot of the women that I met in there had made one or two poor choices in their life, and that ranged, Sylvia, from maybe fudging a little bit on their taxes, right? Or one lady having one or two extra drinks one night at a Chili's bar when she shouldn't have, right? Poor judgment, right? And we all, a lot of people, you know, have these preconceived ideas. Okay, they're in prison, you know, they're criminals, they need to do their time. And it's so not like that. If you think about it, every single one of us makes a mistake, right?
Every one of us.
How many people, yeah, how many people, you know, okay, yeah, get caught or even worse, you know, hit somebody or do whatever. And I realize these are human beings, right? And a lot of them, I had some really, really dark days while I was in Fort Worth in the institution. And I only had 6 months there. But what got me through were that there were women who were there, Sylvia, who had been in there 10, 15 years, right? But every single morning they would wake up with this sense of hope, right? They hadn't had visits or phone calls or letters from their kids or their family in years, right? I, on the other hand, would be able to reconnect with my family and friends in a couple of months, right? But these women who are locked up in there for, they don't even know how much longer, they're still able to wake up with this sense of hope that God's going to make them, help them to see another day and their life would get better. And I'm thinking to myself, and I'm here in my bunk, in my room here, like depressed in this low spot. Like, really, Marion? And they were the ones, right, that helped me to get through. My faith strengthened while I was in there like none other. I'm so fortunate and blessed in so many ways that I got letters from, I can't tell you how many thousands and thousands of people from all around the world saying they're praying for me. And I'm thinking, wow. I mean, little old ladies would put money on my books. They would take up collections in their little churches from across the country, right? They would take up collection and put money randomly, anonymously on my book saying, you know what, we're praying for you, Marion Jones. We don't know you. We could care less how fast you run, right, but you're a child of God, and we're praying for you to get through this. And here's $25. Here's $50 on your book. Here's $75. And that, like, slowly started, right, to open my eyes. That, you know what, I am a unique child of God, and yeah, I made poor choices, but it's okay. He loves me regardless, right? That he knew my plan. He knew what I was going to do even before I was born.
Before you did it.
Books, you know, and that he loves me regardless. I'm here in prison. I'm here in solitary confinement for 49 days, right? But he's still loving on me. He's still loving on me in ways that nobody can imagine. And I was able to get through it, Sylvia, and I figured out while I was in there what my purpose in life is. And that's a blessing in and of itself, because there are so many people in life who are 60, 70 years old, and they still don't know, unfortunately, what their purpose in life is. And I figured that...
I got to take a time out right here, Marion, because you don't know how many days I prayed for you. And the whole time that you were kind of going through the whole ordeal, I tried to reach out to you as well as some of our other teammates. And we just wanted to let you know, like, we support you. We don't want anything. And we didn't know if you were paranoid at that time, but it was almost as if you were – I was one of the people that you said that you were shoving out of your life because you didn't want to hear the truth. You didn't want that. And so all I wanted to let you know was I'm praying for you, Marion. I'm still here for you. I love you no matter if you are a track star or not, you know. I pray many prayers that God would, you know, just surround you, just wrap his arms around you and let you know that you were loved even while you were incarcerated, like that you would just literally feel his love. And so to hear you say that your relationship grew with him and that you actually found your purpose in life, that means everything to me right now.
And I can remember getting letters from, you know, my teammates, all of you guys. And at that point, I'm, you know, there were different phases of all this for me. There was initially there was anger, and then I went through a phase where I was ashamed. You know, and so as much support and people reaching out to me, you know, there's this sense of just feeling ashamed that I've let so many people down. And so that's my way of coping then, was to not reach out, but so appreciative. I can't tell you that the love that I received from everybody. And it's certainly what helped get me through while I was in solitary. I wasn't allowed hardly anything but my Bible, and I like to joke they would allow me a book of Sudoku. But thankfully my love of fitness and my love of sport also is what helped me while I was in there. You see, while I was there, they gave me to sleep on a very thin mat. You're supposed to sleep on it, and they give you these prison issued shoes. I like to call them Bruce Lee type shoes, you know, the little martial art shoes that you shove your foot in. Well, of course, that's not good running footwear. And so what I would do is I would put that little thin mat that they gave me to sleep on. I'd put that in my cell, 12 by 12, right? And I didn't have a watch. I had no sense of time. And so what I would do is I would start to run in place on this mat, and I knew that every 45 minutes the guards would make their rounds, right, checking on all the cells. And so I knew that when a guard passed, I would have 45 minutes until the next guard came through. And so I tell myself, all right, I'm going to run in place for 45 minutes, right? And when that guard would pass, I would start, I like to joke, I was probably in better shape when I left prison than going into the Sydney Olympics, right? Because I spent so much time praying and working out. That's all I had to do. I mean, that's all literally, I was 23 out of 24 hours a day. I was in my cell, sometimes 24 out of 24 hours a day. If the particular guard didn't feel like going outside in the Texas heat to watch me outside for an hour. So many times it was 24 out of 24 hours a day. So I had nothing to do but read my Bible, read my books, play Sudoku, and work out. And so 45 minutes run in place. The next 45 minutes I would do abs. The next 45 minutes I would do a push-up routine, right? Every day I set a rhythm.
Did you keep a journal?
No.
Or write letters?
We just lost her.
Oh.
We just lost her.
We will definitely have to reschedule Marion for another show because we didn't even get to the meat of what I wanted to talk about. But if you're still listening, thank you for tuning in. We will definitely have a part two to this show where we can get to a few more questions. We had a lot of questions, but we were running out of time, and we wanted Marion to at least tell some of her message. And so we invite you to come back next week, next Monday at 7 p.m., where we will be featuring Otis Winston, who is an actor/producer who was just in the movie Oz, and he is now working on a role in the upcoming film Think Like a Man 2. So that's he has an interesting story. He played basketball at Ohio State and went through a lot of timeout moments to get where he is right now. So we look forward to seeing you next week, same place, same time. This is Sylvia Crawley with Time Out, and we'll see you next week.
Tell me what you want, tell me what you see, where you want to go, what you want to be. If you have a dream, you can make it there with a lot of work and a lot of prayer. If you take your time, gotta be precise, gotta have a plan, double check it twice. Wait, hold up, slow down, they won't need advice. Someone's gone before, maybe talk to them, then after you do, go and talk to him. Wait, it's gonna come, maybe not tonight, take your time today, teach
you something right. Got a lot of friends, made a lot of ends, Twitter, you the trend, name a Bentley Benz, but you moving kind of fast. Deep sweats, you gotta make it last, live every day like it's your last, but don't forget to have a blast.